Hey, welcome to the Healthy Postnatal Body Podcast with your postnatal expert, Peter Lapp. That, as always, would be me. Today, I am joined by Peggy and Buddy. They're just kicking back and relaxing whilst I talk to you all by my lonesome. And we're talking about stupid things that you keep doing or keep being advised to do by other people to help heal your diastasis recti. It's one of those episodes where I just go over some of the stupid things I've come across. And it'll be fun, I promise. Right, here we go. Hey, welcome to the Healthy Postnatal Body Podcast. This is the podcast forward. Are we today the 21st of November? And I had a little thing planned for today, but we're pushing that out by a couple of weeks. Because, you know, that's the kind of guy I am. Now, I do have a new setup. Just for people who've been listening for a while, I have a little bit of a new setup that I'm messing about with a bit. So hopefully there will be less clicking of, you know, you can hear my mouse less as I move stuff about. There will be less problems with the sound and all that sort of thing. So, you know, fingers crossed, it will all go well. I hope you're well. It's a beautiful day in Edinburgh. Today is a lovely sunny day. I had just had all five puppies out for a walk. And Buddy and Piggy have joined me in the little room whilst I record this little thing for the next hour or so. It'll be a half hour show. It just takes me an age to do when I'm by myself because I keep screwing things up. And that is the way of the world. So what am I talking about today? Well, I wanted to start by talking about belly binders and all that sort of stuff because I came across another thing that someone sent to me. When I come across stuff, it's stuff that one of you beautiful people sends to me and says, do I really need to listen to the advice that I've just been given? And one of the pieces of advice that somebody was given was, oh, you have diastasis recti, you should wear a belly binder. And no, just no. You do not want to wear a belly binder. I think I've gone over this before. I've definitely written about this before in one of the blogs. The problem with belly binders and corsets and wraps and all that sort of stuff is that they, the posture corrector, that sort of stuff, is that they can give you some temporary relief. That is kind of what they're meant for. If you wear them either whilst you're training or you wear them in the expectation that they help heal anything, then I'm afraid you're going to be disappointed. Because diastasis recti is fundamentally a muscular problem, and it's fundamentally, doesn't matter what kind of diastasis recti you have, it's fundamentally the same solution, right? Whether you have open navel, completely open, or above navel or below navel, doesn't really matter much. Fundamentally, it's a muscular problem. And muscles are not helped by just holding them in place. Right? Muscle weakness and muscle dysfunction is not helped by just holding a muscle in a certain place and then hoping that it will automatically kick in and then do its thing. That is just not how it works. If you wanted a stronger bicep, it doesn't matter if you bend your arm the whole time so that the bicep is constantly in that contracted position. All that does is shorten the bicep because it learns to not lengthen anymore. And it learns to not function properly anymore. This is where a lot of people's pelvic floor problems also come from, which I'll get to in a little bit. So if you were to hold, if you do this now, you bend your right arm and you feel that your bicep is shorter and maybe sticks out a little bit, depending on how big your guns are, right? If you just hold that there forever, so to speak, or for a long time, for hours in a row, all that does is force that muscle to stay tight. What it doesn't do is strengthen that muscle. And the problem you have with diastasis recti is that your muscle isn't strong, your muscles aren't strong enough, and that they're not functioning properly. Part of the function of the old bicep is to be to lengthen and then be able to shorten, right? Just holding a bicep in position doesn't do that. And that is kind of the equivalent of what a belly binder does. Yes, it squeezes stuff in position, but it doesn't strengthen the muscle. So it won't help heal your diastasis recti. Now, in addition to that, you're creating several problems. First of all, by using a belly binder or a wrap or whatever, you're increasing the pressure on your pelvic floor. Right? Think of it like squeezing a balloon, a fully inflated balloon. You know, if you squeeze in the middle, that means that there's more pressure at the top and at the bottom. Right? So if you do that, if you squeeze in the middle, if you squeeze your core tighter, so to speak, by using an external thing, such as a wrap or a belly binder, that means that you're putting more pressure on your pelvic floor and making that significantly worse. And we've spoken about this before, that the pelvic floor is instrumental in functioning, in the proper function of your core. Because everything is connected, right? So we have to make sure that we're not making that significantly worse, especially if we know that the solution we're implementing doesn't actually help help fix our original problem. And the same kind of goes for when you wear weightlifting belts in the gym. I've always said weightlifting belts are for people who are trying to set personal weightlifting records only. That is the only time you should wear one. You should not be doing it when you do anything other than trying to beat Eddie Hall's deadlift record or trying to win a strongman competition. Right? Only on competition days or really intense training days. Weightlifting belts do not help you lift heavier. They help you cheat, but they don't help you lift heavier. They teach you bad form in almost all circumstances. They teach your body to not function properly and not engage your core properly. And that's a bad, bad thing to teach your body. If you teach your body to not use a muscle properly when that is how your body should be functioning, if you teach your body not to use a muscle when it should be using that muscle, you're teaching your body to not function well. And it's a surefire way to train yourself to injury. And I've seen a lot of guys at the gym doing kettlebell swings, which is fundamentally a core exercise, with a weightlifting belt on. And by core, by the way, I include the glutes in that, right? So if you disengage your core, or you have something else do the work of the core because you're trying to protect your back or something silly like that, then you're not using, then I don't know why you're then doing that exercise. Right? If you are scared that an exercise will cause you injury, so in other words, your core isn't strong enough for you to do 100 or 150 kilogram deadlift or a big squat, then you need to drop the squats and start doing different exercises. If you have a particular weakness, so in this case your core, and it's not strong enough to support your squats, then what you should be doing is stop squatting. Or start squatting a bit lighter and do core-specific rehab exercises to help strengthen your core up to the level that you need it to function at. Anything else is just stupid. Anything else doesn't make any sense. I see this so much. I came across this again today when someone said, I used to do diastasis recti exercises on the motor system in this case, and they really, really helped. I stopped doing them because I started doing, I'm not going to mention this in the name of this project product, but it's a diastasis recti safe weight loss thing. I started doing those workouts and I don't have time to do Mutu anymore. So my Diastasis Recti is still there, but you know, there you go, what can you do? And that is just not the way to train. You have to fix your weaker areas before you do anything else, right? Because if you don't, you're going to run into trouble later on. And that's kind of what I wanted to talk about a little bit. So I've heard a couple of things that I came across. So we discussed belly binders, which you shouldn't do. Peloton bikes. Yeah. I don't know, Peloton is wonderful, and they're really, really popular. And when I say wonderful, they're very slick spin classes. So there's nothing wrong with Peloton. But there's nothing for a diastasis recti. So why are you doing it? Right? It's definitely not going to help heal your diastasis recti. What might help heal your diastasis recti is losing a bit of weight, of course. Right? If you're overweight or obese in a, let's say, not just postpartum related obesity, so not just baby weight, then losing weight and all that sort of stuff will alleviate pressure on your core. A lot of the times, a big round belly has to do with visceral fat around the organs. And therefore, in those cases, losing a bit of weight definitely helps. And Peloton bikes, yeah, a spin class helps with that, and it's great for your cardiovascular system. But it doesn't heal your diastasis recti, right? Another thing I came across is someone keeps sending this to me, and God love you. They're saying that, what do you think of Get Mom Strong on Instagram? And I don't mind Get Mom Strong. I think it's fine. There's a lot of useful information there. But I think she would agree with me, because I don't know the woman who runs the show there. I think she would agree with me. she would agree with me that just doing her random workouts that she posts on Instagram, I believe she has a fitness program, right, that she sells, but just doing her random Instagram workouts will not heal your diastasis recti and is completely unsuitable for most people to do. And that is one of the better Instagram things out there. But if you just do random exercises, and I've spoken about this before, I can give you probably top of my head 200 exercises that are useful to help heal diastasis recti. And that's just top of my head. There's probably 800 or 1,000 more. And I can put them together in a way that you have an infinite number of workouts, right? I can create so much with that. And all of them would technically help heal your diastasis recti if you did them all at the right time in the right order. If you don't do them at the right time, at the right order, you're probably going to make your diastasis recti worse and you'll hinder your postnatal recovery. And with that, tooting me old horn and all that sort of stuff, I really know what I'm doing when it comes to postpartum training. So I really know what I'm doing with regards to giving people exercises to do. And I don't post random workouts on Instagram for exactly that reason. Because people keep saying then, just do one of XYZ's workouts. And that is just not how postpartum or any sort of rehab exercise works. I came across something today that Jess sent to me, where she was told, well, where she saw as advice, someone said, I know I shouldn't do any crunches, but yeah, so what else should I do? And the response was, no, crunches are safe to do, which is true, right? If you do them properly, crunches are completely safe to do, if you do them properly and your body's ready for it. And no one will ever convince me otherwise, unless there's a new study that comes out. So crunches are completely safe to do. So at that point, she was right. And then the person said, I recommend doing a minimum of 15 crunches and then building it up. I recommend trying to do 15 in a row and then building it up from there. And I just said, no, see, that's the problem. You have one bit of information and then you add something that is complete nonsense, complete horseshit to that statement. So although crunches are safe to do, starting with 15 doesn't make any sense. How many crunches are you building up to? 100? What are you trying to do by doing the crunches? Because they sure as shit won't fix your diastasis recti. Right? Again, crunches are safe to do, but they will not heal your diastasis recti. So why are you doing them? And why are you starting with 15? That's a random number to start with. No self-respecting personal trainer ever starts by having clients do 15 repetitions of an exercise. There's a reason we're doing 10. And I know that bodybuilders will go, hey, 10's for hypertrophy. Yeah, but that's not why we are doing 10. We're doing 10 sets of one. I talk about this a lot. I want one good exercise and I want 10 repetitions of one good exercise. And we're starting with, again, muscle activation, and then we're putting some strength and conditioning in. 15 reps isn't, that's conditioning stuff, that's endurance stuff. So building up from there, that's like saying, I'm trying to get my legs to get ready to run again. What should I do? Well, start by running a marathon and then build up from there. You just don't. It is insane to start that way. Another thing, what other thing did we come across? Oh yeah, asking your GP for surgery on the NHS. So this is all genuine stuff that I have seen, and I have had people emailing me other stuff, usually screenshots. So if you come across something, peter@healthypostnatalbody.com, if you have any sort of thing that you see, send me a little screenshot. If you think, hey, Pete, is this right? I'm always happy to answer any emails. That's kind of what I do, right? They sent a screenshot and said, yeah, I have diastasis recti. I've had it for 6 years, apparently. I've just been diagnosed with it. What should I do? Well, you should ask for your GP for surgery on the NHS. And this, again, is no. The answer to that is just no. What you should do is your exercises. Exercise heals diastasis recti in 99% of all cases. And it helps heal diastasis recti in 100% of all cases. Exercise always helps when it comes to muscular problems, muscular injuries like this. Now, it doesn't mean that in that 1% of all cases, you don't need surgery. But the vast majority of people that have diastasis recti simply do not need surgery. That is just the way it is. And for you to go and bother your GP saying, I think I need surgery, because I can't be bothered to do the exercises. And that is the implication, right? That is what it is. You can either can't be bothered doing the exercises, you can't be bothered seeing the physio, you can't be bothered to book a personal trainer. Right? If you don't have the money for it, then, you know, I get that you can't book a personal trainer. Then you need to invest time. It is that simple. You have two choices when it comes to diastasis recti. Do the exercises with a professional, and that can be one-on-one, or that can be online, it can be whatever. And if you can't afford to do that, look up how to do it properly. Go to healthypostnatalbody.com, listen to the podcast, read the blogs, go to other websites. Other websites are available. And see what you actually need to do. But what it requires is time. I had an email from someone the other day saying, I went to the physio. They told me to do exercises. I don't have time to do exercises. What can I do? Well, nothing. You can sit on the couch and watch it get worse. That's all you can do. If you cannot be bothered to do the exercises, then there is no help for you. The NHS is quite right in saying that the £5,000 that sort of surgery costs is wasted on you and should be spent on other things than your laziness. I'll be very blunt about this because that is what it is. It is your laziness that stops somebody else. The NHS has a finite amount of money, and your laziness stops somebody else getting cancer treatment. And that is ridiculous. That is offensive. And that is insane, and it should not happen. So do your exercises. I'm really, really quite fed up with people saying, I want surgery. 99% of cases do not need surgery. You just don't. You need to do your exercises and need to do them properly. And don't tell me that, yeah, I saw a physio 6 years ago and it didn't work, because either you saw a shitty physio, which is possible, they are out there. You saw a generic physio, which is possible, they are out there and they won't help. But what you didn't do is your exercises, and you didn't put your time in. I guarantee it. I have yet to have a client, genuinely, PT or online, I've genuinely had to have a client that puts the time in, that puts the work in, that doesn't get results, that needs surgery. I have never had a client still need surgery. And I've seen 52, 54-year-old women come to me who've had diastasis recta for 25 years. And they come to me, and after a few months of hard work, admittedly it's hard work, and admittedly it sucks, and admittedly you need to change your diet, and you need to put effort in, and that bites, and it's not pleasant to have to do that. And surgery might well sound easier, because at least you don't have to do anything yourself for it, other than, you know, take a tremendous amount of time off afterwards, time off work afterwards, and be in pain for quite a while. Other than that, it's a lot easier. Oh, yeah, you have to wait for years and be in pain for years. If you're just doing the exercises and eating right for diastasis recti, so again, that is not a weight loss thing necessarily, but eating right for diastasis recti, you don't drink too much, again, it's a diastasis recti thing, then your diastasis recti will heal. It will. And you should not be bothering other people with it. So to tell other people that you need surgery, or it always requires surgery, or often it requires surgery, is just not true. And the problem with that is, and if you get told that that's what you need, you go see your GP about this, you're basically on a long, long waiting list only to be told to go away. You're not getting it. You can wait a year and a half and you won't get it. You can wait 2 years. I've been in touch with women who have waited 4 years on the NHS, and then they get told, no, you're not getting any surgery. Go away, which is the right answer for them. Go away. But now they're 4 years down the line. They've not put any effort in. They've been walking around with back pain and all that sort of stuff, core problems, weak pelvic floors for 4 years, and they've done nothing to resolve that issue because they were hoping that the NHS would fix it for them. NHS, 9 out of 10 times, will not give you free surgery. And that's the right thing for them to do. The NHS should not be funding most diastasis recti surgeries. And it's insane that people think that it should. This is fixable. This is something that you can fix. And it should not take resources away from people that have severe health conditions. So, like I said, if you wait 4 years, you're in pain for 4 years, you're in discomfort for 4 years, and it then takes longer to fix your problem. Because the longer you wait with this stuff, the longer you leave a situation like this unattended to, the longer it takes to fix and the more work you have to put in. Right? That is just the way it is. So again, if you could stop telling people that it needs surgery, then that would be a bit of a bonus. Right, that's my little rant done. Those are the things I came across this week. And that is just this week. Just a quick summary. Exercise always helps. Just do your exercises. That's all you need to do for diastasis recti. Just get your exercise in. And it'll be fine, I promise. This stuff is fixable. This stuff is always, always fixable with exercise and diet. So why would you not do it? It baffles me. It genuinely baffles me that you can feel better in about 3 months. For most people, it's a 3-month thing where you just do the exercises. And you eat as best you can for diastasis recti. And you eat healthy, which is something you want to do anyways. And you'll look better, you'll feel better, you'll feel stronger, you'll feel more secure. You won't have pelvic floor problems anymore. You won't look pregnant anymore. Your belly will feel better and tighter. You'll feel more confident. And you'll be healthier for it. Those are just 8 or 9 things, the benefits. And all you have to do is do a strength session twice a week and some daily exercises, which takes 10 minutes. Right? This is why Healthy Postnatal Body gives 3 months free trial to everybody. Because within those 3 months, you can get the results you want. And I think this sort of stuff should be available to everybody without them paying the earth, it costing them the earth, or cost being an obstacle. So cost isn't an obstacle anymore for you to fix your diastasis recti. Right? So also don't want to hear, yeah, I'm saving up for diastasis recti surgery on the NHS. If you can afford that, you can afford a personal trainer, and you should hire the personal trainer in every single case. That is what your starting point is. Spend £700 or £1,000 with a PT for 24 sessions and see what the results they can get you. I think you'll be amazed. Anyways, that is me done for the week. Let's have a look at what's in the news this week. Oh, yeah. So in the news this week, I came across a little study which talks about the maintenance of lost weight and long-term management of obesity. There is a lot of stuff floating around online about how it's impossible to keep weight off in the long run. 95% of all diets fail and all that sort of stuff. And this study was published a little while ago, 2019, I think. And clearly shows that the reason for that is that the people who have lost a lot of weight tend not to implement sustainable, healthful behavior, is what they call it, positive weight regulation. So they're not getting any clinical attention, weight management, specific counseling and all that sort of stuff after a few years after losing weight. So it's usually you go on a diet for 6 months, and after that, those 6 months, the diet slips a bit. And that's fine. And then you think you switch into maintenance, but then the old bad habits creep in for one reason or the other. And that is what this study very clearly shows. So it's nothing to do with it being impossible to lose weight. It is just one of those things that you need to keep paying attention to the weight. It's frightfully simple, right? I'm a size 32 long in jeans. And if the jeans start to feel a bit tight, and then I need to put a bit of effort in and need to tighten my diet up a little bit. That is all it is. That is what you need to keep doing. If you then go back to your old habits and just ignore that sort of stuff, that's why people gain weight back. It's nothing to do with constantly being on a diet or constantly needing to eat for weight loss or constantly needing to be doing a keto diet or any of that sort of stuff. It is just you need to be still paying attention and you cannot go back to your old habits. This is why so many dietitians now, even when they say anti-diet dietitians, they're still diet dietitians, right? They're full of shit. I mean, any dietitian that does weight management is a diet dietitian. The clue is very much in the title there. Even if they fix your relationship with food, as they like to call it now, that is the essential bit. If you're emotionally eating too much and all that sort of stuff, if you have a destructive relationship with food, then that needs worked on. But fundamentally, what that boils down to is that teaching you how to manage things properly later on. That is what this study very clearly shows, that if you know how to deal with things properly later on and you rein yourself in when in a healthy way, then you know, weight can definitely be kept off indefinitely, and formerly obese or morbidly obese people can always go back to a much, much healthier weight, but they need a bit of extra help. And it is not that it's impossible to do so. It's just that people don't get the help they need or don't want the help they need, don't want to admit that they need help. And they start lying to themselves about saying, I'm happy being morbidly obese and all that sort of stuff. Right? The study is very clear. I will link to it because that's what I do. And that's the podcast for this week. Here's a new bit of music. Next week, we have interviews again. I did a wonderful interview just before I go. Did a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful interview with Jessica from Run Pain Free. And man, you're going to love her energy. That'll be next week. She absolutely crushed it. Crushed it. It's so nice to have a top level nerdy expert expert on a program. I love these guys. So that's coming up next week. In the meantime, new bit of music, Peter at healthypostnatalbody.com, of course. Give us a like and subscribe if you can. And I'll be back next week. Bye now.